So let me just give it some context first before we get into any kind of discussion about the numbers. I mean, first and foremost, just for the record, we all were sworn in 2 months ago today. And that's a very short time period to compile what amounted to was nearly 1,000 pages of budgets, some 400 in our operating and nearly 600 pages for our capital improvement plans. So to say that it has been an incredibly intense period of time and body of work would be an understatement. But what I'm most proud of is that what we're going to present to you today and what you're going to hear is more than just numbers and what we tried to do during this time of taking over in the midst of a pandemic, recessionary trends everywhere we looked, unemployment high, et cetera, and a lot of issues just facing us in general, given the uncertainty of the times. What we're going to present today really has a lot to do with our operating philosophy, how we molded the numbers, if you will, that we think best serve the people of our island, and our ideas that we believe in, that we think are needed, and are for the greater good. So that said, I am very, very dependent, as I said throughout the campaign, on the men and women who would come to work here one day and lead the city. And a number of them are in this room today, and I want all of them to have something to say when we get into our capital plan. But I would like to start off by introducing, first and foremost, Mike Formby, Managing Director of the city. And Mike has been really the primary architect in everything that we've done in the first 2 months in getting our foundation and building our footing, and led the whole transition team in the selection of the men and women you're about to meet. Next to Michael is Danette Moriyama, who's our Deputy Managing Director. Very proud of Danette. She comes here with an illustrious career, tireless worker. She's brought a great dimension to our operations. Andy Cuano sitting in the middle. Andy joined us 1 week later. He was sworn in on the second, but he hasn't even been here as long as the rest of us, and he's in charge of budget and fiscal services. And Andy had the primary responsibility of overseeing this with his team and people who just, well, I don't know how you managed to get all this done, Andy, but you did. You guys have done it in great form. Going down the room right here, no particular order, Alex Kozloff, in charge of design and construction. You'll hear from him in a little bit. We've given Alex a huge role. In fact, everybody in here has taken on a huge responsibility. Okay, next to him is Sam Moku. Sam's in the room. He's my chief of staff. Sam only started a month ago. Somebody I've known since the 80s. He's already made a great difference and a big impact on our operations. Anton Krucky. Anton Krucky is in charge of housing and homelessness. We've expanded that department because philosophically, we felt, first of all, it was not staffed properly, one person and a secretary, not nearly enough to deal with the issues of housing and homelessness, which throughout the campaign were major themes. We're in our early beginnings right now in what we want to get done in both of those areas. We're working on a number of housing projects right now as I speak. We can talk about those later today, and certainly homelessness, you know, reminds us each and every day, all of us, as to what a significant blight it is on our city and something we're not going to turn our backs on. Next to him is Dr. Roger Babcock from the University of Hawaii. It's BFM. I always want to get confused. I get confused with fiscal services and fiscal management or whatever, but Roger's our go-to guy. As I was running for mayor, everybody said to me, you know, if you could just fix the roads and keep us feeling safe, you'd be a great mayor someday. Roger's got that and a whole lot more on his plate in engineering and a whole lot of other things. You'll hear from him. Next to him in the back of the room, I would say it was our surprise guy that we got in the whole campaign was Roger Morton, left OTS after some four-plus decades and brings an incredible dimension and transportation expertise to us. And we're going to be really heavily relying on Roger because transportation clearly on our island is a major, major undertaking for us. Next to him is Wes Yokoyama, who we were fortunate enough to find Environmental Services as Lori Kaikina moved up to take over rail. Wes is an incredibly brilliant man, has been, and has, and you'll hear him talk about it. We've got major, major projects. It's a major part of what we're going to expend money on. Some of it admittedly is federal through consent decrees, but there are other projects that we've taken on that we think are for the betterment of our island. Behind him, I think I see Mark Wong staying in the background, head of IT. Mark was one of the holdovers. I've known Mark privately for many, many years. Absolutely brilliant man. We've tasked him with the responsibility, which we've already begun to do, and I've already seen full effect of modernizing our city. We are in the second year of the third decade of the 21st century, and much of how we operate is not reflective of that. We need to bring that into place. Next to him is Jerry Popillo. In the back of the room, in charge of enterprise services, we've given Jerry a big responsibility to make money out of stuff that we have that doesn't make money while creating fun and good times for the people. It's not a small task, Jerry, but we appreciate it. Behind him is Laura Thielen. Quickly, I've known Laura, known of Laura. I was so excited to see her come forward and want to take over Parks and Rec. It's something that's very deeply personal to us. Laura has also been very instrumental in what we're going to present tomorrow to the Department of Health in our modifications of Tier 3 and what we hope to be able to put forth here and certainly get sports back on the table for our kids and, for that matter, all leagues using our facilities. So Laura's in the room. Other than that, I got Tim Sakahara here to my right, Director of Communications. He's here with his team, Brandy and Adam, and my assistants back here. So we are at full throttle today to try to provide for the reporters and for you the most comprehensive look, if you will, that we can give you on what we've decided to do in our first 60 days. So let me make this really clear. This is not a report card on what we've done. I would tell you right now, I think one of the first things we did do, and as I just went through introducing these men and women, that was job one, was to create a great team, to create a great foundation, as you would build any operation, and we have that. I can tell you that with great certainty. So it's less about what we've done so far, it's about what we're going to do, and I think that's the whole thrust of the fiscal 22 operating budget. So, look, I've been doing budgets a long time in a lot of different settings, and today we're going to give you, present nearly a thousand page documents, but you know what, that's all on paper. And as we've just learned, the year that we just lived, you know, all bets are off as far as predicting the future. But to the best of our ability, knowing where we are right now, we put together the numbers to create something we think that a year from now we're going to feel really good, and it actually tees us up great for our second year in the administration. So that said, our fiscal 22 operating budget is $2.91 billion. Now that's down 2.3% from the budget that was approved last year at this time, the fiscal year operating 21 budget. That equates to $73 million. And I'll get into that in a little bit as to how that, what we did with respect to that. But that said, you know, when you have less money, things have to happen. So we have our operating philosophy, first and foremost, was to protect our employees. You know, we determined that we wanted to make sure that all 8,656 of the men and women who work for the city and county of Honolulu would not be impacted by the fact that as a result of the recession and the pandemic we've been dealing with, we had less money, that they would lose their jobs. So there'll be no furloughs, absolutely no furloughs. But we will implement a hiring freeze with conditions, okay? And right now we have nearly 2,000 positions that are open. And I'll be candid with you, that's far too many. So the hiring freeze will be precisely that, with the understanding of the following two conditions. One, our hiring freeze will not affect anybody in uniform. Our firefighters, our police department, our EMS, our ocean safety people, all of them, we will hire selectively as we need to on an ongoing basis so that we can best ensure public safety. We have no hesitation about that. That's an investment we need to make, we'll continue to make, and I'll challenge the leadership of all of those areas to make sure that we're at full throttle. Okay? Yeah, in addition to that, we have 1,949 actual vacant positions. That's way too many as an opening. So we have allowed flexibility in our plan to allow us to hire back when we identify people that we believe are going to be able to make a contribution, because some of what is being asked of the men and women in this room right now, candidly speaking, if we're going to actually do that, we cannot do it. We cannot do it with the numbers of people we have. There are some departments that are woefully understaffed right now, and they've had cuts in the past. So we think selectively we can build back. So for anybody that's wondering what does nearly 2,000 vacant positions equate to, it comes out to about $42 million in our budget. But we think we can help, so hopefully in eliminating waste and running more efficiently when it comes to being able to hire some staff, even though we have a freeze on where we absolutely need to have it. I want to be clear, we're going to do that. Okay? So in that regard, that's sort of the top line on our operating. On our capital, our budget is $1,025 million. Now, that's down substantially from the prior year and the plan that was approved and accepted a year ago. That's 25.8% below last year's, or $357 million. That's not a small amount of money, but at the same time, it is over $1 billion. And we've earmarked those monies. Well, if I can just say it, our focus was on community needs, okay? Jobs, and providing greater capacity to our communities and our residents. So that's what we wanted to focus on. There are no legacy projects in this deal. Everything we looked at was from a really pragmatic point of view. You know, how do we make our communities better? How do we connect them? And how do we reach fairly and equitably across all sectors of Oahu? So we put considerable funding into the budget for infrastructure, for connecting communities and providing capacity. And we aligned our city and county efforts with the state in this regard in order to really maximize what we can possibly get done. And we feel really good about that because on a combined basis, the resource there really gives us ample running room. So, you know, we're set up to take full advantage of federal funding opportunities. And, you know, we fully expect in the coming year that we're going to maybe even exceed our own expectations. So that's the top line. The top line is that we're down some $73 million in our operating on what was approved a year ago and some $357 million, but we did not let that get in our way in our determination to best serve the people of Oahu. So I'm going to say it again. We think we can operate efficiently, and we think we can eliminate waste. And the thing I'll say about the men and women you're about to meet, they all share some common denominators. This is a very different group of people. They all bring to the party, if you will, or to their jobs, very different talents. But some of the common denominators have to do with the fact that they're all very successful people. They've learned how to create success, and they know how to drive execution. And they are the kinds of people that I described in the campaign that we wanted to surround ourselves with. People who are smart, smart thinkers, smart doers, who would embrace accountability. And so as we approach this budget, it's not just numbers. It's the story, and it's what we're going to do for the citizens of this island, our residents. So, that said, I'd really like to start off with, I'm going to bring up, let's see, Wayne, we'll leave you alone here. We get into the budgetary matters. We'll call you up. Alex, we'll start with you a little bit on design and construction. And since it's a 1,000-page budget, I think we're going to be here for a couple of hours. I hope you guys don't mind. No, that's okay. Alex, we will all endeavor to be brief, but this is my decision because I really feel that anybody out there, if you have any questions, these are the men and women who I'm going to hold responsible for. They are in the best position to answer things that we're going to do that I think will manifest themselves in the kind of projects we're taking on. Alex.
Good afternoon. My name is Alex Kozlov. I'm the Director of Design and Construction. I'm not here because I'm the first, because I was the most important person. I just happened to be sitting closer to the mayor, so he picked me first. The Department of Design and Construction, we've probably got, you know, a couple of hundred projects in fiscal year 22. $300 million worth of projects. The Department of Design and Construction executes the capital improvement plan. We are not necessarily the visionaries. The visionaries are the people that you're going to be speaking to or listening to later on. They're the ones that come with the ideas. They're the ones that cross-level all the resources and requirements. They're the ones that go to the communities to do all the hard work. My job's kind of easy. I just do the job. I just execute, and the department just runs the construction projects. And I'd be more than happy to ask or answer any questions you have about some of the projects. Some of them I'll defer answers, but if you've got specific questions that you want to ask, I'd be more than happy to answer.
So you say something about Chinatown. We will decide what we're going to do with Chinatown.
So Chinatown. Chinatown is a gem that has unfortunately lost a bit of its luster. We walked the entire Chinatown, or most of Chinatown, last week. The mayor, cabinet members, managing director. And we got some input from many of the kind of the local groups, so to speak. We currently, as of today, have several road repair projects going on. They're relatively substantial. They involve repaving the roads, fixing the sidewalks, installing some curb extensions on three of the intersections. But it's more grander than that. The ideas of how to restore the luster of Chinatown actually exist in Chinatown. The people there have the greatest ideas. And the idea for us is to be able to marshal, capture those ideas, and be able to execute. The construction is construction. It's not complicated. Getting it going and having the vision to do that, to address all the issues, is the complicated part. I'm very confident, though, in being able to restore the luster to that gem. I'm looking forward to do that.
Thank you, Alex. Wes, we'll have you come on up. Thank you. Thank you, sir. So we'll do the Q&A afterwards, Alex. We'll see what they ask. Come on, Wes. I want to introduce yourself again.
Sure.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Wes Yokoyama. I'm the director of the Department of Environmental Services. We take care of waste, so solid, sewage, and recyclables. We usually take up the lion's share of the CIP dollar-wise. We have some really big projects, especially on the wastewater side. This year is no exception. We are going to continue with improvements at Honolulu, following up on the consent decree secondary there. We're actually branching off into like renewable energy. So we're going to build a facility that uses methane as a byproduct from sewage to create power. We also have a number of improvements that we're doing to H power. We're enclosing the third boiler. We're doing an ash recycling project. So ash is a byproduct of burning rubbish at H power, and that rubbish needs to go to the landfill, but we want to divert as much as we can. So this ash recycling project is going to take that ash, and it's going to create construction materials for concrete admixtures, as well as remove metals and recycle that. We also have just our regular sewer repair and replacement projects that are in the budget. So I'm more than happy to answer any questions. Those are the major projects that ENV has this year.
Well, how much money do you think we'll take out of the budget?
I think we're at $530 million.
Yeah. Yeah. Good.
Thank you.
Thank you. Roger.
There's two of us, Mayor.
No, it's okay. Roger Moore, that's right, there's two.
Aloha. I'm Roger Morton. I'm the director designate of the Department of Transportation Services. Our department is responsible for public transportation on Oahu, including the bus system, the handy van system, and our rail system. We're also responsible for planning some traffic improvements in terms of traffic engineering and our traffic technology. We also have a division that is involved with short-range and long-range planning for our transportation. We work very closely with UMPO and with the State Department of Transportation. Our budget this year is emphasizing a few notable things. I'll give you the highlights. We're putting emphasis on continued electrification of transportation. That means that we're putting in the infrastructure that we need in order to charge buses to actually operate. We are going to be introducing 17 new electric buses in the months to come, and we are putting in electrification. We have one project going at the Kalihi bus depot right now, and we have another one that's included in this budget that will allow us to put in some electrification at our Alapai Transit Center. We also have money in the budget to purchase new buses, reduce our bus fleet age, which has been getting a little long in the jaw, really. And we also have put in money to do a planning study, an intermodal planning study, and design for property that we acquired. We have 21 acres at Pearl City, and we acquired additional acreage in Kalihi, where we now have 21 acres in Kalihi, and we're going to do a master plan of that campus in Kalihi. Also, really exciting to me is we're going to be extending our traffic control system down on the west side. We want to get down as far as Nanakuli and Waianae. Right now, our traffic control system really stops in Kapolei. So we want to extend our fiber and get all of our traffic cams, our traffic signals that are going to be coordinated down. And sort of part and parcel of that, we're embarking on a modernization of our traffic signal controllers. We're looking to implement on this island something called adaptive traffic signals, which mean that that we can just do a better job of synchronizing traffic signals throughout the day so that we can improve the flow of traffic. That'll have benefits for everybody on the island, including reducing energy consumption and improving our greenhouse gas profile for that. That's been our emphasis on this budget, has been electrification and improving traffic flow. And I'll be happy at the end to answer any questions that you might have. Mahalo.
Thank you, Roger. Dr. Babcock.
Thank you, Mayor. My name is Roger Babcock. I'm Director of the Department of Facility Maintenance. We have the roads, the sidewalks, the storm drains, the street lights, and as well as maintenance of all the city vehicles, most of the city vehicles, including trucks and ambulances, heavy equipment, and cranes, all that kind of stuff, and especially refuse vehicles. I want to talk about two areas as part of the CIP budget under DFM. The first is rehabilitation of streets. Mayor mentioned that streets are really important, so we have $35 million of CIP on streets, rehabilitation of streets. We like to sort of spread the goodness all around, so there are streets all over the island that are included. I'll just name a few, not specific streets, but areas. We'll be doing repaving in Chinatown, Mapunapuna, Kalihi, Waikele, Wahiawa, Mililani, Waianae, and Makaha, and as well as other areas, pretty much everywhere. And what we try to do is coordinate this with other utilities like wastewater and electric HECO and stuff, so that we avoid repaving right after a project. So we want to pave and have the street not be touched for 10 years or so. So that's rehabilitation of streets. Another big area is stormwater work. So stormwater is a really big thing. There's something called the NPDES, National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System, which is part of the Federal Clean Water Act, which regulates both stormwater and wastewater, WES's area. And this is run by the EPA. So there's a lot of permit required things that we have to do. So we have about $17 million worth of projects this coming year. These are projects that include some small things like some showers out at Kuhio Beach, replacing the putting impervious surface or pervious surface so that water will infiltrate into the ground, as well as some green infrastructure where plants are planted so that stormwater can run off into the plants and then infiltrate into the ground. We have some projects in Chinatown where we're putting in pervious materials also to infiltrate groundwater. We have a project in Waikiki, which is a stormwater outfall that has a gate on the end of it that needs to be replaced. We have projects in to replace a lot of storm drain inlets. So these are on the curbs and the streets, and we put gates on there that are retractable and capture trash and leaves and things that want to go into the storm drain system, because once things get into the storm drain system, they go straight into the streams and into the ocean. There's no treatment plant at the end of those pipes. So we have to do prevention. We have to keep stuff out of the storm water that runs off when it rains, right? So when it rains, all the trash and stuff ends up in our storm water. So we have some big projects with that. And so that's a sampling of some of the projects that we have. And those are also distributed all over the island. And I'd be happy to answer questions about anything later.
Thank you, Roger.
Thanks.
Thank you. Laura Thielen.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Laura Thielen, and I'm the director for the City and County Department of Parks and Recreation. We have the parks, botanical gardens, and also manage a lot of the trees along the city streets. The capital budget for our department, we have a number of line item projects for our parks, but I wanted to focus on three areas that really allow us to be more flexible and nimble. One is the community development block grants. We'll be going into six of our parks and one of our botanical gardens, and we'll be doing a number of replacements that will help refresh the area, increase safety, and increase accessibility. Some ADA improvements, some new playgrounds, some court resurfacing, things like that. The areas that people love to visit, we want to make sure that they're working well for you and that they're safe. In that same vein, we added some flexibility and capital improvement money to our ability to respond to mechanical failures, electrical failures, or structural issues. Our parks are heavily used. They're out in the, you know, beach parks and other areas that get a lot of weather. So sometimes things happen, and we need to be able to respond quickly and be able to do repairs quickly. We've also added some funds that allow us to repave parking lots so people can get into areas, not have damage to your car, and be able to have access and ramps to get your kids and kupuna over to the areas to be able to enjoy them. So I'd be happy to take any questions that you have. And I also wanted to recognize, in addition to our budget, much mahalo to the departments that are also providing support. Roger Babcock talked about some of the projects that he's doing under facilities maintenance that are going to have some benefits to our parks and areas that we share, like in Waikiki, and also design and construction, the work that they do for us.
Thank you, Laura. Jerry, and we'll finish up with you, Mark.
Aloha, Jerry Papillo, Department of Enterprise Services. After all the hard work is done, our department basically is really here for all of you, the residents, to be entertained, to play, to enjoy. And we have a lineup of projects that will really improve the opportunities to come out. Starting off, golf courses have a lineup of projects there. They're really focusing on just improvements inside and outside of the facilities, the course itself, also some clubhouse work, all the way from lighting, electrical improvements, obviously, but culverts and flood control with some of our other departments that are really doing a great job out on the courses to make them more useful year-round. We have amazing space at a couple of the courses, these clubhouses that are underutilized. They need a little bit of work, and we're going to focus on that so that we can invite the public in and make maximum use of those facilities. Next up, the Honolulu Zoo. It's absolutely critical that we have, we've been blessed and fortunate, a carryover, but work ahead as far as our accreditation goes with the American Zoological Association. And that work really is focused on animal care, animal exhibits, animal well-being. And so we'll have some work there that focuses with the chimpanzees, the giraffe, some of our hoof stock, which is basically just a overall generalization of a lot of the mammals, and also the elephants. It's really important that when families come out, that they see the animals in a good condition. They're well cared for. And, you know, really hats off to the staff out at the zoo. They are passionate about taking care of the animals and making sure that they're in good shape for all of us to come and see. And lastly, you know, just entertainment. I know that, you know, we're working through these tiers, and it's very important that while we have a little bit of downtime, we get in and we really get into the nuts and bolts of our entertainment facilities, whether it's at the Blaisdell Complex or also, and we're very hopeful, had some positive conversations with the entertainment industry to just, if we're going to, you know, start somewhere, we're probably going to really focus a little bit on the shell. It's an outdoor venue. We can space people properly. We're working with entertainers locally and nationally, following some real important guidelines that are set across the industry so that we can entertain safely and healthy for everybody. Also, of course, I'm available for to answer any questions that may come up. Thank you.
But our capital budget is usually limited to our public radio system. So this is the radios that police, fire, EMS use to communicate with dispatch and each other during incidents, could be an emergency or a weather event. And our radio is in composed of these two different systems, the part that actually generates the signal and the portion that transmits the signal on the island. And I'm going to talk about the transmission part today. So we have a couple of dozen radio sites, maybe up to 30, that are comprised of varying height antennas. They could be several hundred feet or just a few dozen feet, depending on the terrain, and an attached structure. And these pairs of facilities are subject to high winds and corrosion from the elements. So we're on a regular replacement schedule for these. And this year, we're concentrating on the redevelopment of two equipment sites, mainly upgrading the electrical system, the roof, and just doing regular maintenance on these. The larger portion is for the planning of a major antenna site that we're not ready to go into construction, but the planning and design of these sites takes several years. And as I said, this is just sort of the bare minimum to keep our sites up to date. We're on a rotating schedule, and we're lucky to have completed a major replacement of our radio system last year. It's about a $20 million radio system, and so we just completed that, and this is just to support that installation. I'll be available for any questions afterwards. Thank you.
All right, so just quickly in summary, one of the things I wanted to be sure we got across today to anybody who might be listening and watching is that that's why I wanted all the men and women in this room to speak, and is that I want to make sure the public understands and feels good about the operation of the city. I want to reassure you that the intelligence and capabilities of the people that you just listened to and a whole lot more are going to come into play. You know, we talk about capital improvement plan, the CIP. The operative word there is improvement. And that's everything that we try to do in looking at how we were going to deploy monies and our human resources, if you will, our intellects, our spirits, and everything else behind that to try to make it better, despite right now the uncertainty of this pandemic that we're still in and the recessionary impacts. So if there's anything I want to say to the public today is that we're confident in our abilities to deliver everything you just heard about and a whole lot more. So in summary and final, okay, we have about $73 million less in our operating than was approved a year ago. We figured out a way to do that. Starting first and foremost, though, we want to make sure that all of our city and county employees realize there'll be no furlough. We'll implement a hiring freeze, but will not affect our first responders. We'll ask them to continue to provide for the safety and security of the people who live on this island. And at the same time, as I said, we think there's enough flex in our budget that we can adhere to what we need to do fiscally, but at the same time, hopefully be able to recruit and attract really good people to work for the city and county to make it an even better place than it is today. So with that, I think we'll turn it over, and I'm here to answer any questions and on the operating plan, on our capital improvement plan. I don't know what's gone on in the past, to be very honest with you, but my way of doing things is I wanted you to get an insight to the kind of an overview on how we're going to spend over $1 billion in the coming year improving the city and county of Honolulu. So, questions.
Mayor, this first question is from Rick Daysog. Despite the pandemic, property values have actually increased this past year. What are the city's projections for property tax collections for the upcoming fiscal year?
Okay, good question. You know, right now, we're holding steady. It's kind of hard to predict. People are on installment plans and paying their property taxes. Thus far, we're receiving those funds well. As we've said throughout the campaign, I'll say it again, we're not going to raise property taxes. We can only hope that people will continue to make those payments. We're planning on that, but one never knows. But right now, we're steady as she goes.
If the city is forecasting a decline in property taxes, what is that impact on the city budget?
Well, we'll have to deal with that. And that's what we just dealt with, which is why we wanted to give you that overview. Whether it was $73 million less in our operating than a year ago or $356 million less in our capital improvement, you know, money's a fluid. budgets are fluid. As I said, we printed it on paper, not on tablets. And, you know, at the end of the day, we'll adjust accordingly.
From Ashley Mizuo, just want some clarification on how much the total shortfall is that needed to be accounted for by making reductions.
How much was
that total shortfall?
The total shortfall? Well, when we did the budget right now, our operating was $73 million less than what was a year ago. That's just, it was the way it came out for us. So, you know, as you know, by charter, we have to balance the budget. So if I think I'm answering the question, it was about 73 in our operating.
And she's asking, what were the main reductions that allowed the CIP budget to be reduced?
The CIP reduction, the main reductions? I think the major reduction in our capital improvement plan really had to do with the amount of monies that were allocated. I mean, and that's just the way it was. And so it wasn't any single driver. Our challenge was to figure out the monies we have, you know, how are we going to spend that, which is why I wanted you to hear from everybody. I think we've done a really good job of spreading it around. And as Roger Morton talked about, I mean, we're going to get into Maile and Anakuli and Waianae and provide something that should have been done a long time ago that hasn't been done yet. And we're going to try to provide the distribution of those funds equitably around our island, as you heard a number of people mention today. So it was really about that. I'm not focused on how much less. I'm focused on what we have and what we're going to do with it. Okay?
From Manolo Morales, the previous administration said it was able to offset a $400 million deficit by slashing 10% from every department. Are you following through with this plan?
Andy, you want to address that? Andy Cuano was our primary architect of our budget. I'll let him address that. I have an answer for that as well. But go ahead, Andy.
Thank you, Mayor.
I am Andy Cuano, Director of Budget and Fiscal Services. To answer the question from our constituent, yes, we actually took on and made some tough decisions to reduce our operating expenses at all departments, and it involved reducing our expenses or expenditures in salaries, fringe, current expenses to operate the departments. We also made the very tough decision this year to defer the prepayment portion of our future employee health benefits, and we made sure that we had a way to redeploy the deferrals there to apply and balance our budget such that we can maintain current services for all of the people that live on Oahu. We also are looking very carefully at all of our departments to ensure that we're operating as efficiently as possible. And, you know, the intent is, as Mayor stated, we're protecting jobs, and at the same time, we're also making sure that, you know, core services provided by the city continue to be provided to our public.
You know, I probably should have made a stronger point of that, because I think, you know, in our objectives, our philosophy, if you will, in dealing with the monies was also to ensure, as Andy just said, operation of our core city services. So, you know, we're going to protect the jobs of the employees, but also we're going to provide for the safety and well-being, as evidenced by the fact we're not imposing a hiring freeze on our first responders, and at the same time, operationally, keep our core city services intact.
For some of the reporters that missed the beginning of this press conference, they're just asking if you can clarify if there will be any tax increases.
Only for the reporters who missed the first part of this conference. I want their names, and they're going to receive a special surcharge. I want to know who they are, but no, okay, no.
And are there any proposed fee increases besides Hanauma Bay?
Hanauma Bay is the only one that comes to mind. We've had a lot of discussions with the Friends of Hanauma Bay about that and the resource and all the good things that Hanauma Bay is. It's still one of the most incredible places in the whole world. And if there was a place that benefited from the pandemic, it was, you know, that site. I mean, you know, from the coral to the fish to the water and everything. And so we want to protect that on a going forward basis. So it's not just a fee increase. There'll be less people visiting it. It'll be done by appointments. But I think it needs to be treated like the treasure that it is.
From Christina Jedra, former Mayor Caldwell said that the city would be supplanting CARES-funded overtime abuse at HPD with city funds. How much money will city taxpayers have to pay for those overtime charges that couldn't be billed to CARES?
None.
And has the city dipped into the rainy day fund during the pandemic?
No, we've not done that. But I'll just say, if we have a situation going forward, if we ever have to dip into a rainy day fund, we will use it appropriately. It's not a slush fund. We'll use it for the purposes that it's meant to be. You know, we're hoping for better times ahead. We don't know. As I said earlier, we don't have a crystal ball. And that way, in that regard, that's why funds like that, we used to call them contingency budgets in my former life. You know, you never could predict in a newsroom, for example, whether or not there was going to be a hurricane or tsunami or whatever. That's what a rainy day fund is about. And we'll use it appropriately if we need to, and hopefully we won't have to do it.
This one is for Jerry. Sorry, Director.
Jerry.
From Manolo.
You might want to come up, Jerry.
Yes.
Yeah.
Just asking for details on events at the Shell, how soon that could happen, and maybe even how often.
You know, at this point, it's too early to tell an exact time frame, but we are in planning stages. Again, we're working with a Hawaii Events Coalition. We're working with a lot of promoters and producers. You know, but most importantly, first and foremost, it's about the health of the community. And until we feel comfortable across the board with everybody, that's when we'll be ready. And we're not there yet, but we certainly want to have plans in place. I've walked that property with some of those promoters and the entertainment industry. To figure out, to put together a plan that would be acceptable to everybody in the chain of command to make sure that we're safe and we do it right. We don't want to take a step back, we want to take a step forward.
Thank you. Mayor, this next one is from Ashley Mizuo. The executive summary mentions that employer contributions to the employee retirement system was $4.4 million higher in FY22. Because of pay spiking in some departments because of excessive overtime pay. Which departments is this referring to?
I think it's primarily HPD.
And Christina Judger just wants to clarify, you said there will be no furloughs, but there will be layoffs?
I didn't say there would be layoffs. Never said that.
And
I said no furloughs. No furloughs.
Christina is also asking, your budget is proposing more or less or the same number of Housing First vouchers?
You know, Mike is saying yes. That's a number I'm not exactly familiar with, but I think so. We've tried to be really aggressive on the Housing First, all our housing and homelessness plans.
So more or less or the same number of vouchers?
We have to check.
Okay.
We have to check. That's a good question. We should know the answer off the top, but, you know, 1,000-page budget, a lot of lines.
Another one from Christina. How will the 25% cut to the capital budget affect needed infrastructure projects?
Well, we just gave you that presentation. So we're going to address it and spend the money, $1.25 billion, as judiciously as possible. And so we've said consistently up here today about not only protecting core city services for our residents, but at the same time spreading the money around as best we can.
This one deals with the executive summary. What do you plan to spend on rail and in what areas?
Well, our operating and maintenance budget right now for the rail this year, depending on if we start to actually operate it, is $101 million in the budget right now. There is a lot up in the air with rail, but right now as we're proceeding, we have new leadership. Mike Formby and myself have been having weekly meetings. We feel good about the direction. This past week, I heard from Senator Schatz, I think the release was out in the media, we were able to get $70 million, which is not even part of the transit package that we're anticipating later on for further subsidy, but $70 million to recover monies lost during COVID for rail expressly. I like everything that I'm hearing about the fiscal responsibility of rail from the new leadership team. In addition to that, some of the engineering concepts are being talked about to try to get it built efficiently. So we're steady as we go. You know, as you all know, we were given a handoff on rail. What we promised was better fiscal responsibility, and I feel like we're on that road.
And final one from Civil Beat regarding operating expenses to address homelessness. Is your proposed budget higher, lower, or the same as last year's spending?
I think it's probably about the same, but we expect to work in conjunction and collaboration with the state, the private sector, and the federal government, and quite honestly, some of the meetings that we've already had, Mike and I attended a pretty extensive meeting Sunday morning with some of the major players. We've asked them to stand up some positions for us from foundations, give us some grant money, some resources, and we think that if we do this properly, we will, when all gets said and done a year from today, we will have spent more money on that. It is a major commitment for us, and we're just starting to get our traction.
Thank you, Mayor. That's it.
Okay, that's it. Look, I just want to thank everybody. First of all, I want to thank the men and women in this room for being here today. It's in you that I have great confidence that everything that was not only said today, but even beyond, that the year ahead is going to be very, very good for the citizens of our island. And for our listening audience and the reporters and everybody else, I thank you. We're excited about the year ahead. This job has an amazing sense of responsibility attached to it, not just me, all of us. The one thing that we all do share in common, and I've challenged every man and woman that works here, this is about leadership, this is about being trusted, and this is about making good decisions on behalf of the people who trust us to do that. And in that, you can regard that we will. Thank you very much.